Hi, I'm Max Keller.
Master Ninja theme song!
This is how I usually leave the bar. Stick around. This should be fun.
Yeah, man, I don't like your face.
Yeah, well, you're a jerk.
So, how about a little history party?
I got a dribble.
Here's a name to get familiar with. Master Ninja theme song. Max Keller. It's mine.
This is On Hold with Atchka. I'm your host, Shannon. And this week we have an interview with Dr. Stephen Blair, who is a leading fitness researcher and has some interesting things to say about what it takes to be fit. And he's also at the center of the fat and fit debate and believes that you can be fat and still be physically fit. So very interesting interview. I hope you enjoy this interview with Dr. Stephen Blair.
Hey, I'm speaking with Dr. Stephen Blair. He's the professor with the Department of Exercise Science at the University of South Carolina, as well as the former director of epidemiology and clinical applications and director of research at the Cooper Institute. And he's one of the most highly cited investigators in exercise science, currently with more than 20,000 total citations of your work. So, very impressive resume. I guess my first question is, how do you define fitness in your work?
Well, fitness has different components. The primary one that we focused on over the years we call cardiorespiratory fitness, and that is the kind of fitness, I might call it aerobic fitness or aerobic power, aerobic capacity. But in the research we've done, you get a measure of cardiorespiratory fitness from a maximal exercise test on a treadmill, or you could do it on a cycle ergometer. But that's the kind of fitness that has been most thoroughly studied in terms of, you know, the physical activity health arena. We also have in our large cohort several thousand people that completed a strength assessment. So we would call that muscular fitness or muscular strength and endurance, but that's another kind of fitness. And then a third one that is also probably important to health is balance. And particularly in older individuals, and believe me, I've noticed over the last years, I'm now 70, over the last few years, my balance is just going. And I think many older individuals get affected by this, where you just aren't as sure-footed as you once were. And, of course, this lack of balance or poor balance leads to greater risk of falling and hip fracture and so forth. But I would make those are the three main kinds fitness, although flexibility, movement around joints and so forth, is another kind of fitness. But for that particular one, we don't really have much research on the relation of flexibility to health outcomes.
So pragmatically, what does a person need to look for to know how fit they are?
Well, these days it's easy enough to get a cardiorespiratory fitness test at a YMCA or a fitness center. And across this country, there are thousands of health and fitness centers and probably tens of thousands of qualified staff who know how to do a fitness test. And I'm not talking here about a diagnostic exercise test that the cardiologist might do. I'm talking about just measuring the cardiorespiratory fitness. So it's relatively easy to get that assessment, and it's not terribly expensive, again, at the kind of facilities I mentioned. And in fact, one can even do a self-assessment of fitness. You could, if you go on Google and type in Rockport walking test, you will find a test that has been used for the last 20 years or so, and it's been validated against laboratory measures of cardiorespiratory fitness. And it simply requires you to walk a mile, time how long it took you to cover that mile, and then measure your heart rate at the end of the mile. And you put that in an equation, and it gives you an estimate of your fitness.
Okay, that sounds pretty simple. So what role do you see weight playing in fitness?
Well, the heavier you are, the more energy it takes to move your body. If you're walking, running, doing household chores, or whatever. So there is an association between weight and fitness, but it's far from a perfect correlation. There are plenty of big people overweight by body mass index standards, or even obese by body mass index standards, who are quite active and fit and healthy in other respects. So you can't tell by looking whether someone is fit or not. They're, in fact, in our research, if we look at adult men and women, body mass index of 30 or greater, about half of them are fit by the cardiorespiratory fitness standards that have that we've used in our research on fitness and health outcomes. And also, there are some thin people who are unfit. Mm-hmm. There are thin people who are evil. There are fat people who are good. Remember Timothy McVeigh, the Oklahoma City bomber. Not a nice guy, but he was skinny.
That's true. It's an interesting comparison. So does that, the fact that a person who's heavier requires, necessarily has more of an energy expenditure when they exercise, do they get more bang for the buck when they exercise then?
If by more bang for the buck you refer to a risk of, say, a heart attack or developing diabetes and so forth, I think probably not. Again, our research has focused on what your fitness level actually is, and we see the benefits of having at least moderate cardiorespiratory fitness. We see those being relatively comparable in people who are normal weight or overweight or obese. Now, just in terms of burning calories, yeah, the bigger you are, the more calories you burn, so the more bang for the buck.
Okay. Yeah, that's what I was more thinking was how that affected, I guess, caloric calories in, calories out. And how does that, I mean, people often cite that simple phrase, calories in, calories out. What is your estimation of that, you know, kind of equation? How does calories in, calories out factor into a person's fitness?
Well, the calories in, calories out is a true, I mean, it's an important statement. The laws of thermodynamics apply in the human body. And if you take in more calories than go out, then that excess energy has to be dealt with. And in the human body, we deal with it by laying down additional fat. If you burn more calories, more go out than come in, then again, that energy deficit has to be accounted for in body metabolism, and so we get those calories in by burning some of the fat that we have stored. Now, this is really a pretty simple concept, but it is poorly understood, and I want every person, every certainly adult, I think you can probably teach this to junior high school kids, if you have excess caloric intake, more calories in than being burned, of 3,500 calories, that is a sufficient amount of energy to lay down 1 pound of body fat. Conversely, if you burn 3,500 more calories than you consume, then your body is going to burn a pound of fat to make up for that deficit. So I think everyone needs to understand energy balance, calories in, calories out. I think I deviated a little bit from the question you asked, and I probably didn't get specifically to the point, but you can ask it again and we can go.
Well, is that equation the same for every person? Is that balance maintained for, say, because I've read studies where a heavier person who attempts to lose weight requires more activity and less caloric consumption to maintain the same weight as a person who's never been heavy, that it's their metabolism is kind of it requires more finessing, basically.
Well, yeah, I think if a person has gained a lot of weight, say over, you know, through the adult years, there may be, and I don't think we understand this well, and this is really not an area in which I'm a great expert. But I think there probably are some metabolic adaptations that occur that make it very difficult to take the weight off and keep it off. I mean, we've pretty much proven we don't really have much long-term success in getting the weight off people who have become overweight or obese. But the laws of thermodynamics still apply. It is still burn 3,500 more calories than you take in, you're going to lose a pound of fat. So that applies no matter whether you're a great big person with a BMI of 35 or whether you're a tiny skinny person with a BMI of 19. Energy balance still applies. It just may be more difficult for the person who has become overweight or obese.
So your work with the Cooper Institute is very widely cited, and you've studied tens of thousands of patients. What did your work at the Cooper Institute involve?
Well, it's following the large cohort of patients, which now the data we have is 80,000 individuals who've been examined at the Cooper Clinic over the years, and I've spent the last 30 years following these people to see who lives, who dies, who gets sick, who stays healthy. And a principal thing that we've looked at has been this measure of cardiorespiratory fitness, and that all these people had a maximal exercise test on a treadmill. So we've been busy over the years and continue looking at cardiorespiratory fitness as it relates to various health outcomes. And just bottom line, what we found is that low cardiorespiratory fitness, those who are unfit, is really one of the strongest predictors of morbidity and mortality of anything we measure in this data set. Just for example, 16 to 17% of the deaths, and this is in a, we published a year or so ago, over 50,000 men and women followed for, on average, more than 10 years, and about 4,000 of them died. 16 to 17% of those deaths can be said to have been caused by low fitness. 2 or 3% of the deaths were caused by obesity. And I think it was 4 or 5 or 6% to diabetes. And the only thing that was even close to low fitness in terms of the number of deaths it caused in the population was hypertension in men. So low fitness is a powerful determinant of an individual's health and risk, and it's a powerful factor in deaths in a population.
So would you say that fitness is probably the strongest correlation with heart disease?
It is in the data that that we've been producing and publishing.
Okay. So when people say that BMI or excess weight causes heart disease or it's a strong correlation, how would you address that? What would you say to that?
I say a lot of it is junk science because they have looked at body mass index typically and some health outcome. And I guarantee you, even today, even though I've been ranting and raving about this topic for 15 years, this week there will be articles published in leading scientific and medical journals on obesity and some health outcome, and physical activity will not even be mentioned in the article. That makes it junk science. If physical activity is mentioned, most likely they will say we used a validated self-report of physical activity. And if you go actually read the validation paper, you find the correlation between the questionnaire and the gold standard correlation is 0.3 or 0.4. So that means they're accounting for 10 to 15% of the variance in physical activity, 10 to 15% of the truth. So that is a very poor measure. Now suppose I said, well, I'm going to study fitness and heart disease, and I want to take body mass index into account, but I don't like to weigh people because it embarrasses the fat. So I just have a student sit there and estimate their height and weight. And we've done a validation study. And sure, the student can, you know, get a pretty good estimate, and it correlates 0.4 with the actual weight measurements. People would laugh and say, well, that's just garbage. Well, that's the way I feel about people that ignore either properly measured physical activity or objectively measured fitness and take them into account in the analysis. We've got to move beyond this. that no journal should ever again publish a paper on obesity and any health outcome unless activity or fitness has been properly measured and taken into account.
That is a breath of fresh air, I have to tell you, because it seems like, you know, people who get obese due to poor lifestyle choices, yeah, they're going to have worse health outcomes, but they're you know, chalking it up to the obesity itself and not the lifestyle.
There are plenty of normal weight people with poor lifestyle choices and elevated risk factors and so on and so on. You can't tell by looking. Now, the proportion of people with an unfavorable lifestyle or a risk factor profile will be higher in the obese than in the normal weight. But again, there's a big percentage of obese individuals who are perfectly healthy, thank you very much. And in fact, in our data, individuals who are normal weight but unfit on the laboratory treadmill test have a death rate in the next decade that is twice as high as the individuals who are obese but moderately fit.
That is pretty eye-opening. That's very, very revealing.
Hope you've enjoyed the first half of my interview with Dr. Blair. He's a pretty funny guy, and so I thought, you know, given what he said about fitness, you know, trying to think of what theme we could go with, I decided to go with ninjas because they're pretty damn fit. So this is actually from the movie Master Ninja 1, which was produced by starred Timothy Van Patten, son of Dick Van Patten, who, for you younger people, you might not know. But so I enjoyed this tribute to the Van Patten family. I hope you do, too.
Hey, little circuit guy, what are you working on? You kind of left the theater in a hurry, you know.
Yeah, what's the hoodoo, Skitter?
Dim the lights, guys. I got something to show you. Cambot, play some of that appropriately tension-filled incidental music.
What's this all about?
We can't talk here.
Girl, aren't you being just a bit overdramatic?
Well, sure. But I've stumbled upon a plot that, once exposed, will blow the lid off the entertainment industry. Did either of you two stop to consider for a moment why Timothy Van Patten is in this stupid film?
Patrick Swayze was busy?
Good guess, but I thought of that.
Thanks.
No, we're dealing with something even more terrifying than the Swayze conundrum. I'm talking about a plot more insidious. Gentlemen, I present for your consideration, the Van Patten Project! Sitting atop the Van Patten corporate structure, Dick Van Patten, or should I say Don Dick Van Vito Patten Corleone. His evil plan, to place an annoyingly bad actor, preferably one of his own hellish drop, in every B-grade made-for-TV and low-budget film in Hollywood.
That would be all of them.
His plan is quite simple. He begins his career with the Lunts, gadding about in legitimate theater. Then he snatches a plum role in the television sitcom Mama. The popular show runs until 56. Then, mysteriously, no Dick. Fade to the 70s, decade of shame. Dick explodes across the television screen with shows like the new Dick Van Dyke Show and The Partners, When Things Were Rotten, and Eight Is Enough, a show that launched the criminal career of many a young hack talent. Now, Timothy Van Patten comes forth to do his evil in The White Shadow, The Master. Then James Van Patten gets a small role in the short-lived Western, The Chisholms. And then what happens to him? I don't know. And then there's Vincent. Vincent, who is truly abysmal in Apple's Way and Three for the Road, then became the bionic boy. At least he could smell the bacon frying and had a good sense to become a tennis player. The parallels with The Godfather are inescapable.
Sad when it happens to somebody you know, isn't it?
Enter Joyce Van Patten. Yes, Joyce, sister of Dick, the real power behind the Van Patten Empire. Joyce, like Caligula's grandmother, plotting and planning in the background a string of failures in her wake. The Don Rickles Show. The Mary Tyler Moore Hour. The Good Guys. Her with Herb Edelman and Bob Denver. A show I actually kind of liked, except for the third season when Rufus got rid of the taxi and helped out more in the diner. You know, because then it really kind of...
Crow, would you please get to your point?
I don't have one.
That's great. Okay. Come on, you're coming with me.
We'll be right back after this.
So, I just read an interesting study that you did in 1999 called Comparison of Lifestyle and Structured Interventions to Increase Physical Activity and Cardiorespiratory Fitness, where you found that structured fitness, like fitness clubs, and when you compared that to lifestyle physical activity, which was kind of encouraging them to find an activity that they enjoy and participate in that, they both have the same positive impact on their health. So what does that say to you? What message does that give to people who are wanting to improve their physical fitness?
Well, I think simply it's different strokes for different folks. Do what works for you. In this controlled study, we again randomly assigned individuals. One group got a free membership in a very nice fitness center and a free personal trainer. The other group came to a classroom and sat around and talked about exercise. Now, it's a little more complicated than that, of course. The lifestyle approach was helping people learn how to apply cognitive and behavioral strategies to build more physical activity into their lives. Now, some of the people in the lifestyle group use these strategies and approaches, and I'll always remember one guy. This is an anecdote. It's one person out of the hundreds we've studied, but he was very sedentary and unfit, but he was in the lifestyle group, and he got turned on to the idea. What he decided to do was cycle more, so he started riding his bicycle. And over time, this guy was taking 100-mile bike rides on the weekend. So he was doing very structured, you know, traditional vigorous exercise. Another woman, just another example of a woman in the lifestyle group, she was having trouble when can I find time to exercise? And that's the main reason people give for not being active. So our health counselor, talking with her and trying to get a sense of, you know, she was a working mom, she had kids, you know, she was very busy, and if I just want, for example, taking kids to soccer practice. And so the counselor said, well, what do you do when the kid's in practice? She said, well, I sit in the bleachers and read a newspaper. And then a light went on. Mm-hmm. She said, oh, I could walk around the soccer field. So it's helping people find ways to put more activity into their daily lives. And this might be joining a fitness center and going regularly. Then I have nothing against that. But also, the person who says, and here's another important point, identifying, asking for, and using social support. So maybe you ask your neighbor. You notice that your neighbor's been walking before breakfast. And you say, well, gosh, could I join you for the walk? Or your coworker. And you say, well, instead of just eating here in the company cafeteria, let's walk 15 minutes down the street to Joe's Barbecue. And so we got 15 down and 15 back. There's 30 minutes of walking that day. You do that 5 days a week, you meet the physical activity guidelines. So it's finding ways and what works for you. In my own case, I've been a runner nearly every day for over 40 years. And so it's up and out and get my run in the morning, and that's the way I do it. That doesn't mean it's the best way. It's what has worked for me.
Now something you just said, you said you could like slice that up into little 15-minute segments. Is that, I mean, that is, usually I think of exercise as you have to do a 30-minute chunk all at once to get the optimal results from the benefit from it. But you can just do piecemeal exercise.
Yes, you can, and the research evidence that we currently have allows us to say you can break it up into 8 to 10 minute blocks. Now, would 6 5-minute blocks give you the same? We don't know. If I had to bet, I'd say yes, but we don't have research on that. But we do have research that 8 to 10 minute bouts of walking, and you add those up and get 150 minutes a week, then you're meeting the official Health and Human Services physical activity guidelines, and you're getting enormous health benefit from that.
You make it sound so easy.
Well, it should be easier than a lot of people believe. And that's why, you know, we need to get this message out there. Now, let me also say, Shannon, that in addition to the 150 minutes a week of moderate intensity, the guidelines say, well, you can get the same dose and the same benefit with 75 minutes of vigorous activity. So you run 20 minutes a day, 3 days a week, and 15 minutes another day, you got it. Or you can mix and match, figuring that 2 minutes of vigorous is about equal to 1 minute of moderate. So you could do some jogging or playing basketball or hockey or whatever strikes your fancy. Do some of that, and then some, like I said, walking with your neighbor, walking to lunch, walking to the bus stop and the like. In addition, our current guidelines are you should do 2 days a week of 20 minutes or so of resistance training or strength training. And again, this could be in a gym with weights or weight machines. It could be with resistance bands. It could be lifting rocks in the backyard. You know, it doesn't really matter. But we have learned that muscle strengthening exercises are also beneficial to health. So the well-rounded physical activity plan will include, again, let's say the 150 minutes of moderate intensity activity and 2 days of resistance training.
Can you combine the two? Can you do resistance while you're doing the cardiovascular?
Can probably to some extent, but you really probably need to kind of keep them a little bit separate.
Okay.
It is possible to do what we call circuit training in the gym, dashing around from machine to machine. You can keep your heart rate up by doing that. But the research says you still don't get quite the aerobic benefit. So to be safe, be sure you're getting your aerobic activity as well as your resistance training activity.
Okay. Now, there was a recent article, this question has to do with public policy, where they're recommending to avoid weight gain, they recommend 1 hour of exercise daily, and I believe that's 7 days a week, which is kind of intimidating. And it reminds me of when they upped the daily recommendation of fruits and vegetables from 5 to 9 servings per day. Considering that, you know, about 60% of Americans engage in little to no physical activity, and that only about 10% of the population has a good diet, and the rest have either a poor diet or it needs improvement, do you think that these increasingly stringent standards that are supposed to, you know, motivate people to improve their health, do you think they're getting, do you think they're helpful, that they're increasing the bar, basically, they're raising the bar on these standards?
Well, this recent one you're referring to was not a recommendation. It was a report, a scientific report done by a friend and colleague of mine, Dr. Ai-Min Lee from Harvard and her colleagues. And there, in the women they studied, they did come out with the 60 minutes a day. Now, let me be frank. I have not thoroughly reviewed that article yet. And I do highly respect Dr. Lee. She's one of the best epidemiologists studying physical activity. But I can also say there are a number of other epidemiological studies, including some that we've done, which suggest that 30 minutes a day prevents weight gain. So I don't know why she found the higher dose. But leave that as something for the scientists to struggle over. Again, the first target should be to build up to that 30 minutes a day or 150 minutes a week, to be more precise. For many people, this will be sufficient to help them regulate their weight. For others, it won't be. I mean, I'm a guy who struggled with my weight my whole adult life. I'm 70 years old. I'm now running 35 miles a week, and I have gained 30 pounds over the last 30 years or so. So, I mean, it's difficult, and it's more difficult for some of us than others. So for those who have more difficulty, then they've got two choices. Learn how to reduce their intake a bit or build up more. I do not believe that everyone has to exercise 60 minutes a day to prevent weight gain. Some people do. I don't believe it's likely that everyone has to do that. And again, the bottom line is the 2008 Department of Health and Human Services Physical Activity Guidelines, which are official U.S. government recommendations, actually starts with a statement, doing something is better than doing nothing. So move, if you're that sedentary person who spends, you know, just hours and hours a day sitting and you hardly move around at all, then just get up and move a little bit is a way to start. And even there, the 5 minutes, get up and walk 5 minutes, that's better than not doing anything. So I think we have to be realistic in how we promote these recommendations. And not everybody's going to get to the 30 minutes. Not everybody's going to get to the 60 minutes. But hopefully we can get everybody standing up and moving around a little more.
Okay. So what do you recommend to somebody who's just starting to realize the benefits of physical activity, who's just wanting to get started in that, including someone who is in the obese BMI, who's kind of intimidated by moving their body, by participating in structured activity or any activity, out of fear or you know, whatever reason?
Well, again, it's just start moving. And learn how to apply these cognitive and behavioral strategies that I've mentioned. And a couple of others are self-monitoring. And 15, 18 years ago, we brought the pedometers into this line of research. So wear a pedometer and count your steps. And if you're getting 3,000 to 4,000 steps, that tells me you're pretty sedentary. You're spending most of your waking hours sitting. So if you buy into that and say, yeah, I know I should be more active, you know, irrespective of what your weight is or age or anything else, then I would say use another strategy, which is goal setting. Okay, I'm currently getting 3,000 steps a day. If I were talking with you, I'd say, well, what do you think you could get next week on your pedometer? Could you, say, get 500 more a day? You know, give that a try. See if you can, well, you know, 500 steps is really not much. You stand up and move around a little bit, you're going to get more than 500 steps. So that's goal setting. And then next week we talk, and I say, did you do it? And you say, yes, I did. I got 700 more a day. Hey, that's great. Now let's try to ramp it up a little bit more. How many more do you think you could put on next week? You say, oh, I can get another 500 on there. Or you might say, no, I didn't make it. I didn't make my goal. Then another cognitive and behavioral strategy, or another behavioral strategy, is problem solving. Well, what got in the way? What prevented you from reaching your goal? Let's think about it, talk about it, and come up with a strategy to get over that hurdle so that you can meet your goal. So it's things like that that can help people. You mentioned some people might be afraid. I think the evidence is pretty clear that the dose that I've been talking about, the 150 minutes of moderate intensity a week, is very safe. And sure, if you get up and start walking, you might step down off the curb incorrectly and twist your ankle or your knee. But that might, you know, people who are very sedentary also have some musculoskeletal injuries. We were part of a large study called the Lifestyle Independence for Elders Pilot Study. We recruited men and women 70 to 89 years of age who already were suffering from some mobility disability and some loss of function. And, of course, people in that age range, you know, the vast majority of them had 2, 3, 4 chronic diseases. And we randomly assigned them to successful aging or to physical activity. And over the course of at least a year, and some of them went a year and a half, the what we call in the business adverse events, and again, that can be a simple strain or sprain all the way to dropping dead.
That is pretty adverse.
Yeah, that's that. Well, we actually would call that a serious adverse event, of the hospitalization or dropping dead or having a heart attack. You know, the adverse events in those two groups were essentially exactly the same. Exactly the same. Now, we weren't taking these old people out and playing hockey. We were, again, using mainly some walking and doing some resistance training and a little balance training and gradually building up. But you do that, the risk is minimal. Now, having said that, some people, young or old, thin or obese, some people have undiagnosed heart disease. And if they take my advice and they get up and say, okay, I'm gonna walk 5 minutes and see how it goes, and they walk a couple of minutes and they begin to feel a crushing sensation in their chest, pain in their chest radiating down their arm, that's a bad sign. Stop and call 911. So, I mean, these things do happen, but they are very rare. That is, the serious adverse events are very rare. So people, I mean, the risk is much greater for being sedentary. fact, one of the famous people in our field, Professor Peel of Ostrand, used to say, you need your doctor's permission if you want to be sedentary. Or you need the doctor's excuse.
Okay. One last question, and I'll let you go. We're at our limit here, and I appreciate your time. I know you're very busy. Are there things that people do every day that are exercise and they don't even realize it?
Oh, that there can be. It could be, housework and yard work. My little grandchildren are visiting us this week, 5 and 2.5, and I'm sure that the 5-year-old is perhaps the world's premier personal trainer for grandmothers, and I'm sure he's giving Grandma quite a workout this morning. So, things like that you don't think of it about as, you know, I'm not going to the gym and sweating and getting a heavy-duty workout. But it's don't sit so much. Be up, move around more. And again, whether that's at work or in the yard or at home or, again, playing with your kids or your grandkids, take them to the park and try to make them sit. See how that works, you know. They're going to be active, and you can go along with them.
All right. Sounds like some very solid recommendations. I like the small steps approach rather than the dive all in. I think that's a lot more doable for most people. So I greatly appreciate your work. It's very eye opening, very good stuff. So thank you very much for your work and thank you for your time talking today.
My pleasure, Shannon.
All right, have a great day, sir.
You too.
Bye.
Hope you enjoyed the interview, and be sure to visit us for post-interview analysis at fiercefatties.com.
Master Ninja theme song! Master Ninja theme song! Master Ninja theme song! Master Ninja theme song! Because those Van Patten brothers are so headstrong. Master Ninja theme song, help me! Master Ninja theme song! Master Ninja theme song!